Hey, it's your girl Shay Baby from the Brown Book series. It's going down October 28th and 29th here at Old Town Alexandria at the West End. Hey, let's go on the inside so you guys can see where all the magic is going to take place. Hey, so we're inside the lobby of the West End. Come join us upstairs. Hey y'all, we're gonna have an elevator, I promise.
Hey y'all, hey, it's your girl Shay Baby from the Brown Book series, and I'm here to tell you guys about Raw. That's right, the Raw Experience, Romance Readers and Writers Experience, and it's going down right here at the beautiful West End, October 28th and 29th. Oh my God, it's so much that'll be going on, you do not want to miss this. We have book signings with your favorite authors, Beverly Jenkins, Brenda Jackson, Deborah Fletcher Mello, Iris Boland, Maisie Yeh, and that's only to name a few. And you already know, I gotta bring the celebrities to you. So the legendary ball is going down Saturday night featuring Grammy Award winning artist, Miss Regina Bell. And my boy Coco Brown from the Fat Cat Players will be blessing us with his sundress. Registration is open right now. RawExperience.com. RRAWExperience.com. Again, that's RRAWExperience.com. I'll see you October 28th and 29th here at the Westin in Old Town Alexandria.
Open up your brown book, baby. It's for you, it's for us. The fantasies, no one can judge us, no one can judge us. This is for us. Open up your brown book, baby.
Hey y'all, hey, it's your girl Shay Baby, and welcome back to another episode here at the Brown Book Series. Tonight I have such a wonderful guest, honey. I was reading her books for a while now, and I'm like, how long, girl? Can you come on over here and holler at me? And she's like, girl, what's up? What you mean? Here I come. So tonight, ladies and gentlemen, I want you to welcome Miss DL White. But before she comes on, y'all know the routine. It's Wednesday night. It's 7 o'clock. It's time to get busy. The Brown Book Series is on, so call your friends. Let them know. Come on over here. Check out Miss DL White. Get your drink on, and we'll be right back with women's fiction and romance author DL White.
Brown Book Series presents RRAAW, The Raw Experience. October 28th and the 29th, 2022. It's all going down at the Westin Hotel, Old Town Alexandria. Not only will you meet and greet with your favorite authors, there's so much more. A live performance by Coco Brown of Fat Cat Players.
Why don't you put on one of those lovely sunglasses that I bought you?
And Grammy Award winning Regina Bell.
Silver moon shining on my bed, beside my pillow.
Regina Bell, live. Registration is open now at RawExperience.com. RRAWExperience.com.
And we are back. Brown Book Series. Please welcome for the very first time here on the air with us, but she's always a fan of the show, Miss Women's Fiction and Romance author extraordinaire, Miss DL White. Hello, DL. How are you?
Hello. So happy to be here.
I'm so happy that you are here, honey. I really appreciate you for accepting our offer and blessing us with your beauty.
Thank you for asking me.
Yeah. So DL,
I had to read the email twice. I was like, what? Who is that what? From?
Girl, quit playing. Don't do that. Quit playing.
I'm just giddy. I love it.
Man, listen, I tell my crew, they're like, Shay, you have to expand to everyone. I'm like, well, hold on. Let me get one more of who I want to be in here, and then y'all can expand. So they was like, but you know, my one more, you know. They did good. And actually, you are the last episode for the season.
Yeah. All right, let's close it out.
Turn up. So that's why I told him. I said, okay, let me get one more for my season. And then season, what is it, season three coming up? Yeah, I like in season three. Then, you know, y'all can, you know.
All right.
You know, that ain't going to last, though. Because I need all my favorite authors, and you're one of them.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much.
I've been having brunch. What is that? Brunch and Ruby? Ruby's brunch and scent.
Yes.
Girl, brunch was my thing, honey. I was like, hold on.
It's my favorite. It's my favorite.
It is my favorite as well. So, Miss DL, please tell us a little bit about you outside of the literary world, because we're going to get into that. You know, we know you're a beast in writing. So, outside of that, what is it like in a day in the life of romance author? DL White.
Yeah. I'm gonna be disappointed because I don't be doing much but reading, watching Law and Order and Bones.
Oh my God. You are just like me. I love Law and Order. The original one.
The original.
Yeah, they're cool, but the original one.
Yeah. Yeah. The original just, yeah.
It's the best.
Yeah. So, yeah. I'm a daughter of an Air Force man, a career Air Force man. He retired when I was in high school. So he's been retired a long time. My mom was an airplane machinist. She worked for Boeing for a long time. My family lives all up in the inland Northwest. I live in Atlanta, Georgia. I work for a beverage giant here in Atlanta. You all know which one that is.
Yes.
Love the job. Also love the security, the 401k, the health insurance. Love it. Big fan of beaches, big fan of fried chicken, big fan of a nice walk on a flat path, big fan of brunch. That's pretty much me in a nutshell. I'm a regular kind of gal. That's pretty much me. All the excitement is inside the books.
It is a lot of excitement inside the books. Now, you said, honey, two of my favorite shows, Law and Order and Bones. Now, Law and Order, the original, right? Because I'm just
the original.
Okay, the SBU unit, they're good, but I don't know. After Elliot left.
Exactly. After Elliot left, I couldn't hang.
I can hang. And then it's like, but Bones? I was watching Bones last night, honey. I love Brennan and Boo.
Yeah. Like, yes.
I love them.
I love it.
I should have named him Seeley. He's like, really? Seeley Boo.
I love that name. I love that name.
And their chemistry. When you think about like chemistry of different people, different couples on television, like they are just awesome.
Yes. And it helps with, you know, writing and story development and relationship development. Like that was a slow burn. That was a really slow burn. And it's delicious.
It was slow and steamy all at once. And then the times when you thought they were going to get together and they didn't. And but then when they did, I was just like,
listen,
it was beautiful.
I was just so frustrated. I'm like, come on.
Girl,
love it.
The scene where she says she finally want to be with him, and he was like, "I got who we had? Heather, Rebecca, he had somebody."
Hannah. I just watched it the other night. Hannah is not what did you call it? A something prize?
Consolation prize or something like that.
And she listen. I'm yelling at the TV, yelling, see, he told you and he gave you a chance and you were like, no. And so he moved on and now you changed your mind.
Yes. But when she started crying that she lost her chance, girl, I was crying. I'm like, give her another chance, boo, please. Oh my God. But I was so happy when Hannah turned down his engagement, his proposal. I was like, whoo. But yeah, I love it. So girl, yeah. Yeah, we can talk about Bones all day.
I feel you. You're right here in my heart.
Yes, girl. I'm telling you, I absolutely love Bones. That's like one of my favorite. Period.
Love it.
Just absolutely love it. Now, DL, you are an independent author. Did you want to be independently in the beginning, or were you like, okay, I'm gonna try this traditional route? It didn't work out, so F y'all, I'm gonna go independent. Or how did it work out for you?
I started out wanting to be a traditionally published author because I started writing like early 2000s, like 08, and indie wasn't really a thing. Like the only people publishing traditional were like really not well-written or edited faith-based novels. Right. And so my friends who all had MFAs in creative writing said, no, you don't want to do that. You want to write a good manuscript and send it to an agent, and you want to be signed. That's what you want. And so I wrote Brunch at Ruby's, and I researched agents, and all of them said, not for me. I just don't think I can sell a fiction novel set in the South about three best friends. Like, what do you mean you can't sell that? It doesn't even make sense that you can't sell that. So I was like, well, I could not write this book. I could not publish this book, or I could like keep writing it and put it out myself. Like, even if only my mom and I buy this book, I'm just going to publish it. It might be a piece of crap, but it'll be published. So that's kind of where I ended up going. And I was like, reading other authors, because by this point it was like 2011, 2012. Right. Indie was kind of kicking up, and I was seeing these authors putting out these gorgeous books. I was like, that's self-published? Interesting. And like, I'm just watching people like put their books out and like not waiting for some people at Big Five to tell them that they're a good author and yes, I'll publish your book. Like, just do it. Like, I'm going to figure out how to do this. I'm going to write this book. I'm going to get it edited. I'm going to publish it. So that's what I did. The first iteration of that book is really ugly, but it's done.
That's all that matters. It's done.
And yeah. And then after that, I was like, well, no, what? I guess I need a backlist. Yeah. So I just kept writing.
I absolutely love it. Now, when you wrote your book, right? Put it in there. He was like, all right, I'm gonna upload it. I'm going to put it out there. Let's go. Your first review, were you like, oh, I mean, like, what was your reaction to your first review?
I'm sorry?
Your first real review, not your mom and them. I'm talking about the first real review.
You know, I think I was surprised. Because I really expected people to tear it apart.
Really?
I was bracing for impact because my experience in reviews is people just being ugly on the internet. And I was actually very surprised. Like, I always look for like people I don't know. Like, I know my friends are gonna be nice to me, stroke the ego, whatnot. I appreciate that. I read those when I'm feeling bad. But like the strangers and the people who aren't obligated to love it are the ones that really mean a lot to me, because they could say anything and they came to my book and gave it good words. And I think that was the first time outside of like my mom and my friends where I really thought I might actually be good at this. Like this could be a thing. I think I was really surprised, but like, I don't read my reviews because they give me anxiety. Like even the good ones, they just make me so anxious. Like my butt goes numb. If I go to Amazon, like I say, I need information. I go to Amazon. I make sure that my eyes stay like up here so I don't scroll down. And happen to read some reviews, like I look at the star rating, like, okay, yeah, 4.6, good, we're still good, I'm good, that's all I need to know, because people really, truly like to hop on the internet and just be mean, and yeah. I'm sensitive about my stuff, need that,
right?
I don't need that, so I don't take it in. So no, I don't, yeah, after about book three or four, I just stopped reading them.
I totally understand it. And I get, I was talking to one of my my author friends. Well, my friends are the author, I'm not author anyway. And I was telling her, I was like, yo, I don't like the whole, when they give you the A, B, C, D, F ratings. I just don't like that. And she's like, well, Shay, you know, it builds character. It builds. I said, but man, someone, they're passionate about their thing, you know, their stuff. And I'm like, these people pour their heart in their books, and that's their passion. And for you to just tear it down like that, like, I don't like that. I'm like, if you don't like the book, don't just, you know, if you read the book and you don't like the book, right, keep it moving. You know what I'm saying? I get the critics, right, that you do a good job off of, mm-hmm, you know, reviewing and whatnot. Don't tear it all the way down. Just give it, you know. Honey, I was looking at one review. They told this woman book to P-E-E-E-S-S.
Oh, no.
And I was like, what you on the road? Ain't nobody wrong. You know what I mean? Like, take the good out of it, what you like. It's
yeah,
weird. It was, yeah,
yeah.
It's great. So I get you.
I don't mind an honest review. If you didn't, go ahead, write it up. I'm not in it because that book is written, and I'm gonna rewrite it because you didn't like it. So you are talking to readers now about why you didn't like the book, and people that don't like that might read it, might not. It might affect them, might not. What it's not gonna do is affect me. So yeah, you're more than welcome to not like it. You don't need to tag me in it. I don't need to.
Yeah, don't tag me in it. Right. That's what I say. I say, yeah, no, I'm good on that. I'm absolutely good on that. And now this brings us, speaking of books, it brings us to the first segment here, the Brown Book Series, called Name That Book, where we take your synopsis, a passage, a character, or something pertaining to one of your books, and you have to name that book.
Okay. I've been thinking about this segment. Like, do I know my books? Do I really know my books? Okay.
Yes, you know your books. Let's see here. Here we go. Now, you know, you're a friend of the show, so you know I can't see. So hold on. All right, Dia. You ready to name that book?
I'm ready.
Right, here we go. First up. My favorite time of the day was 3 o'clock, especially in the summer, especially on a hot summer Friday. Name that book.
That is Leslie's Curl and Dye.
That is Leslie's Curl and Dye, girl. You're a Porter Lake book one from your Porter Lake series, Miss Leslie's Curl. Honey, that series was funny. I was like, Miss Leslie, Next up, name that book. Character, Angie Blake.
A Thin Line.
That's A Thin Line. Look at you knowing your books and stuff, girl.
I know them.
Okay. Look, we're gonna see, because you know sometimes you're right, full of tricks over here, girl. We're trying to trick you up a little bit. Hold on, here we go. All right, name that book. I love this book. It was so cool. A Faded Brunch and an Unlikely Cupid.
That is The Kwanzaa Brunch.
Now, DL. Girl,
let's talk about it.
Let's talk about it. Yes. Tell us a little bit about this book and what was your idea behind, like, what prompted you to write this type of book?
Let me tell you, I'm blaming this book on my friend, Tarita.
Okay.
We were watching, I don't know if you've ever seen it. Sandra, is it, what is her name? Semi-Homemade. That's Sandra Brown, is that her name? She had a show on the Food Network, and she made the ugliest Kwanzaa cake I've ever seen in my life. It had tears, and it had like these big candlesticks in it. Like, seriously, Google Kwanzaa cake Food Network, it'll pop up. It's
it's horrific. It's like this brown goop with like seeds and crap around it. And she's like, this is my Kwanzaa cake. And so Tria and I were watching this and laughing. And she was like, what if you wrote a story about somebody who made a cake like that? And I said, don't talk about it, because it'll start writing itself in my head. And then once that happens, the people don't shut up until I write the story. And she's like, oh, you should have not told me that, because I'm going to talk about nothing but this cake until you write this story. And it just started rolling in my head. The Kwanzaa brunch is about, it's a workplace romance about Sienna Charles, who is just kind of going through the motions, tired of the same old, same old. She meets Booker LaSalle, who has moved to Atlanta to turn over a new leaf. He is just getting out of a nasty breakup with the boss's daughter at his old company. So it would not be good for him to dip his pen in company ink again, but Sienna is fine. So yeah, it's a romance. So guess what happens?
Listen, I love it, girl. Sandra Lee. I just pulled up this.
Sandra Lee, yes.
Girl, Miss Sandra Lee, her whole, but well, you know what I'm saying?
It's awful. So in the story, it is Sienna and Booker's boss, who's like the new CEO. She's trying to be chummy with all the new employees by having all these brunches that employees are required to. And because she's got them in the office the day after Christmas, she decides to throw a Kwanzaa brunch that everyone's invited to, which means you better come down and eat cake. She is a very, what was that movie Tyra Banks was in where she was like super prissy? I don't know, but that was kind of her in my head. And she's like, smart but a little bit ditzy, and she's like happy emoji because she doesn't even know umoja. So that's like the boss, and they all just kind of like cake looks delicious, ma'am. And then like behind her back, like, what is with this cake? That's ugly. Yeah, so I also don't do work lunches. Okay. I don't do potlucks.
Yeah.
Neither does Sienna, because I just don't know. I don't know what animal did the backstroke in that punch bowl while it was up in the cabinet. Like, y'all be letting your cat sit in the fridge, sit on the counters, inside your bowls. And
my grandma used to say, I don't know who got cats and who got dogs. I don't, I was used to be like, what does that mean?
And so that's kind of the setting for the Kwanzaa brunch. And then the guy that puts them together is kind of like, no, you can't date her and you can't date him. And they're excusing. And so guess what happens?
They date anyway. And it goes from there. Girl, now hold on. Side note. I'm over here tripping, and I'm probably going to get in trouble for this. Rams just said, well, don't say it. Girl, what? Don't you have some kind of qualifications more than being a baker to do a Kwanzaa cake?
I don't know what possessed her. I don't know what possessed her to make it, but it was horrible.
It was horrible. And I'm just looking at her like she looks uncomfortable trying to, she's telling what Kwanzaa means while she's trying to make this cake. Girl.
I can't remember. I don't remember. It's been some time since I watched that video, but.
Girl, I'm about to cut this off. I'm going to feel confused. And you know, when you said, you know, I'm just, you know, you said Sandra Brown, I'm just expecting to see someone of color. And I'm like, what is
this? Yeah. Girl. Sandra Lee is who I meant. Yeah. Semi-homemade. It was semi-homemade, all right.
Yeah, Miss Sandra, you need to don't do that with Miss Sandra. Stick to the carrot cakes and what's it called? The fruit cakes and stuff. Stick to those, Miss Sandra. We appreciate you, though.
Yeah.
All right.
That Kwanzaa cake to us.
Yeah, leave the Kwanzaa cake to us, girl. Just eat it when we make it. Don't don't you attempt. The struggle. Hey, name that book. I lean into him, into the kiss, into the moment.
Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh. That could be any book.
It could be, but
oh my gosh. Like, I know this line, but what book is it from?
Yes, girl. She said, I lean into him, into the kiss, into the moment.
It's not Dinner at Sam's, because I remember that kiss.
Right.
Is it Beach Thing?
No, girl. It's been a while, though. But no.
Is it? Oh, dang.
It's It's Brunch at Ruby's. Now, this is your first novel.
My first novel, which is actually like women's fiction with romantic elements. So I don't think I remember all the
kisses and stuff.
All of the nitty gritty of that book. Yeah.
Girl, I remember it. So tell us, Alyssa, this is the novel that brought D.L. White to the world. Tell us a little bit about Brunch at Ruby's.
So Brunch at Ruby's was born of my own brunch group. I had a group that I think we're about 10, 12 years strong. We don't really meet for brunch anymore because the pandemic killed that. But we were meeting monthly. We met on Twitter and like somebody knew somebody who knew somebody who knew somebody. And we were all from different walks of life. Like one was an attorney and one worked for the state and one's a professor and another is a banker and one was a paralegal and I was an executive assistant. And we would just get together once a month and talk about life and love and give advice and laugh. And I mean, you know, brunch could last 2-3 hours, with, a group of 8 women. So this story kind of just started writing itself in my head. And like I say, if it starts writing itself in my head, they don't shut up until I write it down. And at the same time, I was driving back and forth to work, listening to NPR. And if you live in Atlanta, you know about the public schools cheating scandal. I mean, the superintendent was indicted. Teachers went to jail. I mean, it was a huge case in Atlanta. And so I'm just listening to this unfold and my mind just started touring, like, what if the characters was kind of embroiled in some kind of scandal, like not a cheating scandal, but something that could like rock her entire world, like the ripple effect could be vast, like it's just gonna wipe her out. And so that's how Deborah was born. Deborah and Willard are like my anchor couple. They're like the dream couple that everybody wants to be, but underneath there's some turmoil. And Deborah ends up making a huge mistake that ripples through her life, her friend's life, her career, her family. So that's like my hero story. And then she's got 2 of her best friends that she has known since childhood. Maxine, who pretends like she was born with a silver spoon in her mouth.
Girl.
But she wasn't. She's just pretentious.
Maxine,
she's hateful. I wrote her that way.
Yes.
She's hateful.
Yeah.
I wrote her that way. Thank you so much. And then Renee, who most everybody relates to. She's taking care of her dad. He has Alzheimer's. She moved back to Atlanta to take care of him, not thinking she would be here for long. And at the start of the book, it's been 4 years and her dad's not sick enough to be put in a home and the house is not ready to sell. And she's running this little bookstore that her mom started, that her dad kind of just kept going in her honor. And so she's really kind of in a position where she's stuck and she just needs like a way forward. And so when we meet these women, they're kind of at this precipice of life where something needs to happen. And then we just really learn about the bond between these women and how far that bond will bend before it breaks. So
I love the sisterhood.
That is my brunch at Ruby's. Yeah.
Yeah, I love the sisterhood in this book. I was like, this is hot. So I was like, this is cute. Girl, yeah, Maxine, honey. Maxine had me laughing sometimes. I like Maxine. Baby, she went on joke. I was like, okay. But it was cool.
Yeah, she's a real one.
Yeah, she's a real one for real, girl. I was like, this is hilarious. All right, next up, name the book. Can two people, each determined to accomplish what they set out to do, find a way to meet in the middle? You know what they say. Life is what happens when you make plans.
That is the Never List.
Girl, that is the Never List. I said, I know DL did not write about no 40-year-old virgin. Girl, I was over here tripping.
I did.
Yes, did. I was like, she ain't never. They didn't want to start reading the book. Because first of all, the cover got me. I'm like, this cover's hot. I love that cover.
Yeah. Yeah, it's my favorite.
Yeah. And I'm like, girl, what happened? So what made you write about the Never List?
I just wanted to write something different. I wanted to write a different story. And I think virgins are not a different story, but a modern, mature virgin
is
a different story because there could be so many reasons for her to be 39 and have never taken that step. And I just wanted to explore what that would mean and not make her not make her a prude and not make her a shrinking violet and not bring it all back to religion. She'd saved herself for a marriage or saved herself for a man or anything like that. Like when I look at reviews about virgin heroine trope stories, the complaints are all the same. And, you know, it's that she's chaste and she doesn't know anything. And then like 37 seconds later, she knows a bunch of different positions and, you know, she's doing it like she's been doing it her whole life.
Throwing it,
right? I kind of wanted to write somebody that like she knows her body and she knows what it will take to please her. She also knows what she's worth and she knows what she wants that experience to be. And, you know, there's more of me in Esme than there is in any of my other heroines because I was a late in life virgin. And I know the longer that I waited, the easier it became to say no.
Wait, I was not. Okay, girl. Look, we know we had to get out your business. Was it 40?
I was 40. Yeah. Yeah.
Were you for real?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
DLI.
Because the longer I waited, the easier it was for me to say no. And I would meet someone and it would be obvious that all he wanted was to get to the cocoa. And I mean, like, how do I know that you're going to make this good for me? Like, you've done it. I haven't.
Right.
This is about me. This is about my experience and what I want. And I would just get a lot of, girl, come on. Like, I don't care. Like, girl, whatever. And like, I just don't feel like that's conducive to like romance and a good first experience. So that's a turnoff to me. Like, like Esme's sister says in the book, if I'm going to wait, I want it to be good. I want it to be worth the wait. And you know, I waited because I wasn't ready. And when I was ready, nobody really wanted to kind of give me the feeling like it was going to be fun and friendly and open. When I was ready, men were looking for women who were more worldly and experienced. But I didn't always live in Atlanta. I moved to Atlanta in 2003. So, anywhere and everywhere, the men were kind of the same.
Yeah.
So, you know, when I finally took that step, it was because it was what I wanted to do. And the time was right for me. And I felt like I was going to have a good time because you already know what this is about.
Right.
This is about me.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. So I put a lot of that in this book, but also the thing about being a 39-year-old virgin is you're not a shrinking violet. You're not a person that doesn't know anything about anything. And so, yeah, Esme and Trey got it in before they got it in. If you know what I'm saying.
Yes. Girl, how do you
put
her name? Esme.
Sometimes I just like look at TV shows or like be walking around the building at work and like, I like that name. I'll write that down. I heard it somewhere and loved it. And when I started writing this character, she was Esme from the start. I changed Trey's name twice before he was Trey, but she was always Esme.
I absolutely love it. All right, but Hey, that's what
I'm very proud. I'm very proud of that book.
Yeah, that was a good book. That was a good book. I'm a fan of that book. I'm a fan of the brunches. yeah, you had a couple of short like novellas, little short stories and stuff. I was like, do you know this down there getting it in? And speaking of getting it in, it brings us to the next segment here at the Brown Book Series called Who'd You Rather? Well, we pit your heroes against each other and you let us know which one you want to have a one-night stand with.
All right.
She's like, Shay, come on now. We just start getting it in. Now you want one-night stands? Yeah. I mean, you know, all it takes is that first time. Once you know, got a taste of, you're like, okay, cool, let go.
Right.
All right. First up, who'd you rather? Cade
Casey Kavanaugh
or Taja Franks? Listen. Let me tell you, side note, what you're thinking. Me and my friends was going back and forth about that. And I'm like, look, just because he was a basketball player, honey, that don't mean nothing. I done dated a whole lot of them. I was like, what? Give me my money so I can go. So,
I think I'm gonna have to go with Taj.
Okay. All right.
Which is surprising because I was almost over to KC is one of my favorites, but I think I'm gonna have to go with Taj. I think it's the boy band R&B group background that is just that's really close to my heart.
Girl, he gonna sing me to sleep. I was like, yes, Taj. All right, next up, who'd you rather? Trey Pettigrew or Preston Reed?
Trey all day because I want to punch Preston in the face.
It was Trey all day for me too. Preston, Preston was a little different, girl. All right.
Listen, my betas were like, do you want the audience to hate him because it's working?
It was working.
Yeah. A lot of people don't like Preston.
I found Preston cute though. I was like, he's kind of cute, even though he just had issues in his life. All right, next up. Who'd you rather? Oh, Trickery. Booker LaSalle or Wade Marshall?
Oh, man.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go with Booker.
I'm going with Booker, too. Yeah.
It's that Louisiana swag.
You know what I'm saying? Girl. Hey, baby.
Yes. Come on here, say Boudin one more time.
You know what I'm saying? I love it. I used to date a guy from New Orleans. And then, baby, he'd be like, what up, girl, that head, baby.
What? Yes.
And in the argument, girl, I say I'm not even going to argue with you. I'm just going to get mad and I speak. Because when we start talking, that Creole swag, whew.
Yes. I was in New Orleans in October and I was like, oh, these accents gonna get me.
I'm telling you, it was a mess. It was such a mess. I broke up with him via email because I was like, if I talk to him, he gonna change my mind. And he's dead wrong. I had to break up with him. He left an email. Let me just talk to you. Nope.
Don't talk to me. Don't talk to me.
Don't do nothing. Don't come by. Don't talk to me. Don't do nothing. We're broken up. Move on with your life. I'm sorry. We can't even be friends. I'm sorry. Girl.
But I'm going to save all your voicemail messages.
Every last one of them. You hear me?
You're listening like.
I'm having a bad day. Hey, baby. Look. Whew, struggles of it all. Oh, girl. Whew. All right. DL. Author's moments. What's your most urgent priority for the rest of the year, both in the literary world and in your personal life?
The most urgent priority in my personal life is to get back on the beach. I have a beach trip booked for Labor Day. I'm very excited about it. Yay. I'm just going to Tampa. That's like my quick getaway spot. But I love it there.
Girl, St. Pete. Clearwater is awesome. Love it over there.
Yeah. Yeah. I usually go to St. Pete. Mm-hmm. So yeah. Author-wise, I haven't published since 2020. Mm-hmm. I have to get a book out. I don't care how much of a piece of crap it is. I gotta write a book. I gotta write a book. So I'm working on a book, but
yeah, maybe something sweet and short. You know what I'm saying? Something that you get get the juices back flowing, you know?
Yeah, I gotta stop letting the world stress me out. I haven't really been able to like think, but it's really bothering me that I haven't published since 2020. I have another Potter Lake book that I'm working on and I really want it to be out in 2022. Get back on the horse.
It's going to be out. I'm going to get back on the horse and it's going to be like you never left. You know what I'm saying? It's just like you never left.
Yep.
All right. Next up, author's moments. In being a novelist, what did you learn a little too late?
You can't listen to everybody.
Mm-mm, girl.
You can't listen to everybody. You can't be like everybody. Mm-mm. All you can be is yourself. And I messed myself up trying to emulate what other people were doing. Trying to do it like this author and do it like that author. I'm me.
Right.
I am just me. And the best thing I can do is learn how I work and learn how I write and use that to my advantage, use that strength to my advantage. But I just got so hung up on trying to listen to every piece of advice. Like, you know, your first book is crap. No, your first book isn't crap. Like, you should never publish your first book. You should definitely publish your first book. You should have a blog. No, you shouldn't have a blog. You should have a mailing list. No, you should not have a mailing list. Who needs a mailing list? Like, I had so much in my head, plus trying to follow editors and agents and all of them. I follow maybe two because I found so many agents like blasting potential authors or clients about the work that's being sent to them. Like, you got somebody's dream in your hand and you're on Twitter talking about how ridiculous you think the story is. Like, that's so disheartening. Like, what if I submitted my manuscript and I'm on Twitter watching you make fun of it? Like, that really jaded me, particularly toward traditional publishing and being an agent and author, because so many of them were, and authors too, just releasing all their frustrations online and talking about how authors have to be. And it just, not all of it applies to me. Right. I don't have to listen to all those people. So I unfollowed all of them, every last one of them. And then only started adding back people that were where I want to go, that were giving good advice that made sense, that were teaching courses that didn't cost $1 million and weren't, here's how to write a book in 7 days. Like that's just a money grab, you know?
Yeah.
So you can't be like everybody. You can't think like everybody. You can't act like everybody. Get to know yourself.
I absolutely love it, girl. You preached the good word right there, DL. Yes. I know that's right.
Thank you.
Girl, it'd be crazy out here. Okay, office moments. If you could have tea with one fictional character of yours, who would it be?
Oh, gosh. Oh, tea with one of my characters.
You know, we said tea, but as my little nephew used to say, if you want to put a little loco in there.
I'm sorry, you were garbled. Say that again.
I said, I say tea, but as one of my nephews would say, if you want to put a little liquor in there, we're cool with that tea, with that too.
A little bit in the tea?
Yeah, if you want to, a little bit in the tea, or you want to just take out the tea, just have the liquor, you know, whoever you want to sit down and have a drink with.
Gosh. That's a rough one. I don't know. Maybe. Girl, I don't know. I always say Maxine is my favorite. She is actually my favorite character because she's so blunt. But Maxine is modeled after my best friend. So it's like having a drink with my best friend. So
right. So it would be Maxine. It would be Maxine for me too. So we be extra together. Okay. So we do Maxine. All right. DL, if you could sit down with your 15-year-old self, what would you tell her?
Keep writing. Write more. Read more. I mean, I was always a reader, always a writer, but write more, read more. And one day you are going to get out of that small town and you're going to make something of yourself. So just work toward that.
That's it. I absolutely love it. Author's moments. What would your pen name be?
I used to have a pen name.
What?
But I couldn't remember it. So I was like, you know what? Let me just do this.
You couldn't remember it? You know what? What do you mean you couldn't remember, like, when people would call you by it, you didn't answer?
Well, I mean, even when I go by DL, like in my life, everybody calls me Dom. Nobody calls me DL except people in the book world. Mm-hmm. So when I would do like, when I go to do like a book fair or an author signing, people just be talking to me and I have no idea because I don't go by DL in my regular life. So my pen name was Melinda Jones. And then I was like, I don't think I like that. And also if my book was in a store, I wanted my mom to be able to go buy my book in a store and like people to be able to tell that we're related. I wanted her to like be proud of like, this is my daughter. Right. So I was like, let me just do DL White because I will remember that. And I don't look like a Melinda. And then I was like, what's my name again? Something. I don't remember. I couldn't remember it. So.
You know what? I absolutely love it. Yeah, you look like a Melinda. I'm glad you kept it DL. Yeah. Yeah. That's
I could just barely remember that.
See, listen, I absolutely love it. All right, let's see here. Arthur's moments. If you could master one instrument on earth, any instrument on earth, what would it be?
I would love to play the piano.
Oh, yeah. The piano is
amazing. Yeah, I think, yeah, it's beautiful, beautiful music. I would love to play the piano.
Okay, the piano it is, honey. Mm-hmm. All right, let's see here. Office moments. What's one dream that you've tucked away?
I mean, aside from somehow hitting somebody's bestseller list, I don't think I have too much tucked away. Yeah. It used to be being debt-free, but we on that. We debt-free up in this piece.
Praise the Lord.
That was like the last. Yeah, it was like the last thing. My dad did that for me. Praise the Lord.
Okay.
So, I mean, if I could somehow hit a list like USA Today bestselling, that would be awesome. I would love
that.
Probably way far off, but I would love it.
Well, no, you know, hey, death and life is in the power of the tongue. Put it in the atmosphere and it shall be up, given unto you. That's it. I'm telling you, girl.
Right.
So this next I'm telling you, this next book you do, you'll be like, oh, okay, come on. Yes.
Speak it.
Speaking, put it out there. All right, author's moments. What's something you try really hard to like but just couldn't? Think like girl,
raw oysters.
Raw oysters. Yeah.
No man. Never again in life. No. Also Nutella. I really, really tried to like Nutella.
I tried to like Nutella too. Something about Nutella is I don't know. I don't know what it is.
Tastes like spoiled chocolate.
And it got like a little grit to it. It's something, yeah. It always tastes like somebody was already had it in their mouth. It just to me, I was like, it just tastes like somebody already
doing this.
So yeah, I tried Nutella. I can't do Nutella either, girl.
I really, really tried. If you want me to starve to death, just put me in a house with no food in it. With a jar of Nutella, if you want me to starve to death, that's how you do it. I will not eat it.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. Now, the oysters, you know, I'd be in the mood sometimes to the raw oysters. But I like the cooked ones and the blackened ones. Oh, my God. In New Orleans, they got, like, the blackened oysters. And sweet Jesus.
I keep hearing I should have tried them, like, fried or...
Oh, yeah, and fried, yeah.
Like, you know what? I'm just going to live the rest of my life never eating them again.
No, dear. We're going to get together. We're going to go to New Orleans and you're going to try a fried oyster. Okay? And then we're going to tape it so all the world can see. You're going to try a fried oyster. It's going to be good.
I don't promise to like it.
Don't promise. But at least you might not tell you, but like, I'm going to be like, see y'all, you know, DL and I ate three of them already. Mm-hmm. I can't get her to leave the table. Well, this moment's DL. If money was no object, where would you live?
On a beach. Probably like Greece. Like Santorini is lovely.
Yeah.
Definitely access to a white sand beach, so I need it.
Okay. All right. Greece it is. I absolutely love that.
The retirement plan is to move to like St. Pete, Tampa area and be like 15 minutes from the beach and not 4 hours. That's the retirement plan.
I got you. Yeah, my friend, she just retired in Tampa. That's what's the whole thing. I'm going to be on the beach. Yeah, but she loves San Diego, though. I was like, well, she was San Diego from Chicago, from Chicago. I would have went back to San Diego. That's just me. But, you know, she was like, I want to retire. That's what she said. I was like, whatever. I don't care. I would have to get a job working a pole or something. I would have to just be there. At this moment, what is something that you are amazingly good at that when you do it, you're like, nah, that's my joint right there. I can do that. That's me all day.
I was going to say I can read backwards and upside down, but I don't think anybody's going to fight me for that job.
What?
Yeah, I can read backwards and upside down.
I can read upside down. I can't do the backwards thing. That, you know, that was a challenge for us when we was younger. Read upside down. So I mastered that. But I read it backwards. I was like, I can't.
I don't know what it is about my eyes. It's because I'm blind, but I can do it. Something else I'm really good at.
Yeah, that's good right there.
I don't know. I somehow end up being like the trip planner, the person that gathers all the money for somebody's getting married, somebody had a baby, somebody's aunt's sister's cousin died. I'm the person that corrals everything together. People depend on me to be that person. I guess so. I guess that's what I'm really good at.
Yeah, you're trustworthy. You got a great planning, so that's good. Girl, I'm with you on that. All right, let's see. Author's moments. What's one mistake you keep repeating?
See now.
See?
I don't make the same mistake twice.
Right.
I'll make a different mistake every day, but if I do that one more time.
I get you on that. I know.
Make the same mistake twice. Like, oh no, I learned my lesson. No.
You know, first time, like I'm good. Yeah. I get you on that.
Although I will say, I don't say I keep repeating, but I did let somebody break up with me and come back twice.
Oh.
We're not doing that. We're not doing that again. We don't know him anymore. It's done.
He's a stranger. Get this stranger out of my house, honey.
I don't know this man.
I get you on that. I totally understand that. Oh my God. DL, dead or alive? If you were hosting a dinner party and could invite 5 people from any era, who would it be?
5 people from any era? Dead I'm going to say, who am I going to say? Shirley Chisholm.
Okay.
Because I just want to hear her talk.
Yeah.
Oprah Winfrey.
Okay.
Because I want those two to talk while I'm in the room.
Right. He was surely got to say, because Oprah going to be awesome. Yeah.
Who else? I'm going to be cheesy and say Martin Luther King, because he died before I was born.
Okay. That's not cheesy. You want to make your dinner type of girl.
Right. All this greatness around me. Somebody funny, Betty White. I love me some Betty.
Me too.
Last one, Jamie Foxx. That man kills me. I love him.
He's going to hit on Betty White. Watch.
And she gonna be into it.
Is she gonna
be into it?
If she don't hit on him first, yeah, let's go.
Wouldn't that be fun? Jamie Foxx makes me he makes me choke. I laugh so hard. I love him.
Yeah, Jamie is a good. His body is banging. I'd be like, Jamie, what you been doing, boy? Okay, I absolutely love it, DL. This has brought us to the end of our interview. We have one question left. But before we go, I just want to say thank you so much for coming on. We really appreciate you. This has been awesome. So before we ask this last question, tell everybody all things DL. Where can they go to your website, your social media handles, and where can they get your books, your latest books? Because, girl, you got to write some more books. So where can they get your latest books?
You can find me at booksbydlwhite.com. You can get all my books there. All my links to my social media are there. I am author DL White just about anywhere. I'm mostly on Twitter and Instagram. I am on TikTok. I don't hang out there a lot, but I am on TikTok. So follow me. I'm trying to get to 1,000 friends over there.
Girl, that's about it. Girl, listen, TikTok, I can't understand it.
It's a mess.
It's a mess. You know, I can understand Twitter either. That's why I don't really be on Twitter. Like, I think my crew be on Twitter trying to put Brown Book series, but I don't understand it. And it'd be such a crazy, so much craziness going on over there.
Yes.
I'm like, how do you know the beginning of this thread? Where does it end? Where does it start? Who started it? Why? Is it, girl?
Listen, it's a lot. I try not to get in too much mess because it's stressful, but you gotta find your little pocket. I have like a list of people that I just hang out with that list, and occasionally I venture out to main Twitter. Like, what y'all doing over here? Nothing.
Right. Okay.
And we're back. So otherwise it's just too much. It's too much. Yeah.
I get you on that. I totally get you on that. DL, last question. If you were writing a book about your life, what would the title be?
First, I need some coffee.
First, I need some coffee. Listen, I understand that because sometimes my phone be ringing, waking me up out my sleep. And I'm like, well, hold on. Let me just get a cup. And then I can get my life together. Then I can understand. I'm like, okay, now run that by me again. What happened?
Right. Now that I'm awake,
a little coherent. You know what I'm saying? Give a damn a little bit. Tell me why you woke me out of my sleep.
Yeah, I got to get up, get it all together. At my desk, I got my coffee, I got my water. Okay, now I'm ready.
I get you on that. I totally love it. Brown Book Series, please give a warm, warm standing ovation to women's fiction and romance author, Ms. D.L. White. Thank you, D.L., so much for being here. You are so awesome.
Thank you so much for having me.
And I appreciate you for always supporting me through the last couple of years. I see you in the DMs. I see you when we have in our live shows. You always there rocking with us, and I truly appreciate that.
Yes, ma'am.
Truly appreciate that. Brown Book Series. Hey, crew, y'all know what's up. Every Wednesday night now, y'all know the summertime. We went from on Mondays and Wednesdays. And like I said, this is our last show for this season. We'll be back with season 3. I don't know, September sometimes. Look, Ramsey will have y'all all informed. But just be mindful of our new time every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. We're only doing Mondays in the summertime. So don't look for me on Mondays in September, y'all. Every Wednesday night at our new time of 7 p.m. Y'all got the rundown. Y'all know what's up. Make sure you check out Sarah McClain's Faded Mate. She drops Wednesdays at 5 o'clock. On Wednesdays, after you check me out, at 7. Wait, before Tuesdays at 7. Reese, you know, me and Reese switched up. Reese Ryan, she's coming back with Authors Behind the Story. I finally got it. Thank the Lord. Authors Behind the Story. So Reese comes on Tuesdays at 7 p.m. On Wednesdays, you're going to check out Sarah McClain's Faded Mate at 5 o'clock. Then you're going to come play with me at 7 p.m. And then Wednesday night, again, after you leave me, you're going over to Cruise, on over to Cruise Radios, and be with Iris Bowling at 8 o'clock for Iris Moments. Woo, that's a lot. But hey, we have so many wonderful romance authors that we just want to bring their story to you. So, you know, you got to watch, you got to support. You want to keep reading, you got to support these authors. Again, thank you, DL, for being here with me tonight. Y'all guys know what's up. I see you. Hey, I see y'all later on. Stay safe, but most of all, stay positive.
Open up your brown book, baby. It's for you, it's for us. The fantasies, no one can judge us. No one can judge us. This is for us. Open up your brown book, baby.